welcome to INFS 111, Information in Society, and we'll be looking at what makes up this course in terms of information in society. But first of all, let me point out to you that we are told that knowledge is power, and by association, information is power, because you derive knowledge out of information that has been used. And so when we say that information is power, or knowledge is power, what it means is that the one who has information has power over the person who doesn't have the information. And so if you have a type of information, or if you have an item of information that is needed by somebody else for one purpose or the other, maybe decision making, maybe resolving an uncertainty, you can sell that information that you have to the person, because the person is going to use it to and gain or benefit from it. So information is important. That's why it's important for us to study information in society. Let me also inform you that if you are going to stay with information studies, the course that you have been given, it means that you will see a reflection of all or most of the courses that you will be reading in the department from level 100 to level 400 in this course that you will be taking. So it is very important that you pay attention to this course. Now, we are told that we are in the information age, and it is true, we are in the information age. This is because the society is driven by information. That is, our 21st century society is driven by information. So individuals need information, groups need information, communities need information, organizations need information in order to be able to survive. Nations also need information to be able to survive. That's why it is important for us to study information and how it impacts society. And so we'll begin. Our first session is about the impact of information in society. And by way of an overview, it is just to let you understand and realize the pervasiveness of information in the world that we live in. The session will also deal with information activities in our daily lives, which we may or may not be conscious of. A lot of the time, we get information without consciously being aware that we are even getting information. And objectives that we hope to achieve by the end of the session is for you to be able to match devices that we use for information to the mode in which the information is received. You will be able to describe how information is used in society to control and influence behavior. You will also be able to discuss how individuals differ in their ability to access and use information. You will be able to explain how the use of information is changing the world today. By way of topics that we'll be treating, our first topic will be on the daily encounters with information. Topic two will be information devices around the world. And topic three will be uses of information in society. So let's begin with our daily encounters with information. Now, there are so many ways in which we interact with information, from the time we wake up from bed up to the time we go back to bed. Some of it are mostly unconscious. We get information unconsciously. And so, for example, orally, we interact with information or receive information orally. When I say orally, what I mean is that we hear or listen to information all the time. So by the time you wake up in the morning, your radio is on, or you tune your radio and start listening to the news of things that are happening or things that are happening, traffic congestions somewhere along the line. So we hear information, we listen to information. Then gustatorily. Gustatorily, meaning that we taste information or we receive information from taste. And so, for example, if your girlfriend prepares a stew for you and you taste it, you take your first taste, you realize that there's something missing. What information are you getting from what is missing or from the stew that you are eating? Information is that maybe the salt wasn't enough, or there wasn't salt in it at all. So you get the information that no, something is missing. So you will convey that information to your girlfriend or your cook, that I think that you didn't add salt or enough salt to this stew. Then olfactorily, from our sense of smell, we also get information. For example, as you sit in class or as you sit with your colleagues, if somebody has put on a nice smelling perfume, you'll be attracted to the person. You may even comment the person on it. On the other hand, if you sat by the person and there is a pungent smell coming from the person's sneakers, you might want to move away. What information is being conveyed to you by your sense of smell? That you should avoid such and such a person, or you should draw closer to such and such a person. And so, yes, our senses of smell also disseminate information to us, or also point us towards a particular information decision that we will need to make. And then tactilely, by way of touch, when we talk about tactile, we mean touch, the sense of touch. Our sense of touch also conveys information to us. For example, the lady sitting by you, if you touch the lady, you'll be able to see that she has a very supple skin or flesh, or very hard flesh. You wouldn't want to touch her a second time. It will convey a certain information to you. The way you even touch her will convey a certain information to you. And then visually, of course, when we are reading or when we are watching a picture, for example, what we see on the picture conveys information to us, and we may use that information for the next decision that we will take. Now, in the process of interacting with information on a daily basis, we may transform information into a different format, from one format to another format. Let's say, for example, a piano student or a student who plays the organ. From the notes on the music manuscript, the organist or the pianist is able to produce melodious tunes that you can dance to. And so information can be transformed from one format to another. Now we talk about impact of information in society. Information is escalating. Information is in abundance in the society. That's why our present era is called the information age. But information is getting out of hand. What we mean by information, escalation of information, is that information is getting out of hand. On a daily basis, information grows by leaps and bounds. For example, information that was produced in 2002 is described as equivalent to 37,000 libraries with their collections the size of the Library of Congress. Now, the Library of Congress is found in the United States of America, and it is the largest library in the world. It has several millions of materials, including print materials, non-print materials, as well as electronic materials. And so you can imagine, sometimes I even try to bring it home, closer home to us. For example, if you were born before 1990, or if you were 10 years by 1990, I wonder whether any of you in the class today was born before 1990. But if you were born before 1990, and therefore you were about 10 years old by 1994, you would have realized that there was only one radio station in Ghana, Ghana Broadcasting Corporation, and only one TV station, GTV, Ghana Television. Then again, in terms of newspapers, there were only two basic newspapers, Daily Graphic and Ghanaian Times. Forget about the fact that there was the Mirror, which was a weekly paper, but come from the same stable, or the Weekly Spectator, which also comes from the same stable, from us, the Ghanaian Times. That is New Times Corporation. But today, when you turn your dial, you catch a new station. I'm told that in Accra alone, we have over 100 radio stations, not to mention other parts of the country. So you can see between 1994 and 2016, the rate at which information has escalated, even in Ghana. Now let's get back to what I was saying. Approximately 800 megabytes of information for each person in the world. That is the information that was produced in the year 2000. And to translate to approximately 800 megabytes of information to each individual in the world. And then information produced in 2006, it was estimated that digital information that was produced, or digital data that was produced in 2006, amounted to 20 exabytes. I challenge you to go and look up the meaning of exabyte. It's a measurement of, or it's a unit of information. Just as you have kilobytes and megabytes and gigabytes, yeah. The individuals use an increasing array of information devices by way of sending, by way of receiving, by way of recording, by way of tracking and manipulation. And so in 2004, for example, over 60% of all American households had computers. More than half of all American homes had internet connections. And then in 2005, it was reckoned that 80% of adult Americans had internet access, either at home or at the workplace. Now I'm using America as a standard, because in the world, everybody looks up to America because of America power, American influence, and the American dollar. And so we all look up to America. But these are standards that we should be attaining. Unfortunately, we don't have statistics and records in our parts of the world for us to be able to use to see how poor we are performing or how well we are performing. Yeah. Now and again, in 2006, It has been reckoned that the average American home had 8 radios and 2.4 television sets. So now you can even look in your own home and find out the number of television sets that you have in your house, number of radios that you have in your house. In my house, for example, I have about 6 radios, not necessarily functional, all of them. We use about 2 or 3 of them. Then we have 4 televisions, 2 flat screens, and then 2 etikopo, as they call it. We only use the flat screens. We are not using the etikopo. So you can also look into your own household and see the kind of things that I am saying here. Now, broadband penetration, when we talk about broadband penetration, we are talking basically about internet access. Broadband penetration increased from 11.7% inhabitants in June 2005 to 15.5% in June 2006, within a period of just 1 year. And so these are to show you how information keeps growing from by leaps and bounds on a daily basis. Now, information devices. I mentioned earlier on use of information devices for tracking information, for disseminating information, for receiving information, etc. In 2006, it was common for an individual in the developed countries to use one or more of the following information devices on a daily basis: the computer, the clock, a watch, a radio, a printer, a telephone answering machine, a cell phone, a DVD player, a personal digital assistant, PDA, as they call it, a fax machine, a calculator, MP3, a thermostat, a calendar, a CD player. Now we have MP4, so pardon me for telling you MP3 because it's old. A digital camera. So again, look into your own lives. As you sit now, I am sure if I put it to you, we'll be able to produce a watch on your wrist, a telephone in your pocket, a digital camera, or this is because we have smartphones, we don't use digital cameras much anymore. But I'm sure you have a laptop, and so at least you will be using on a daily basis 3 of such devices. Again, in terms of information services, back in 2006, an individual is most likely to have used one or more of such services: a telephone service, cable television subscription, satellite radio subscription, internet access, security monitoring service, wireless phone service. Again, as we sit, if I put it to you, you have a telephone service that you use, cable television. If you are watching DSTV in your house, it means that you are using telephone, you use cable television service, you subscribe to it. You have internet access, you use it on your phone, that is on your smartphones, you use it on your laptop. Now, if you are living in a Transaco Valley, for example, I am sure you have a security monitoring service where any intruder will be monitored even from your place of work or from the police station. And then total media usage. And so at the end of the day, we can compute the media that is used. And this has been done by the International Telecommunication Union. And so total media usage in 2008 was reckoned to be 4,059 hours per person. Here we are referring to people who watch television, people who listen to the radio, people who read books, people who go online, they browse, people who play video games. And so we are told that total media usage in the year 2008 amounted to 4,059 hours per person, where television viewing was the first with 1,669 hours per person. So what it means is that you, as you sit here, for example, you spend 1,669 hours watching television. Kukum Bagia, Nigerian films, those were the things that you spend your time on. And then radio was second with 1,032 hours per person. What it meant was that a single individual spent 1,032 hours listening to the radio. However, newspapers, magazines, and books decreased. What it meant was that people were not really patronizing print material, which is symptomatic of the period in which we are. We are in the electronic age, or we are in the digital age, and so people are more inclined to using digital things or electronic things than print materials. Use of other media like the internet and video games increased. Now you may try your hands at this sample question. The conduct of daily life is affected by the number of different information devices for sending, receiving, recording, tracking, and manipulating information that one owns. So cast your mind back. Which of the information devices that you use would have been available to your parents when they were your age. For example, if you are 18 now, your parents may be about 40 plus. What do you think are some of the information devices they are using today which will be available to them at the time they were your age? I'm sure you have been following what I've been doing so far. Our next topic is information devices around the world. So we want to take a look at what is going on around the world. So cell phone subscription, for example. Again, statistics from the telecommunications, International Telecommunications Union show that in 2005, number of cell phone subscribers per 100 inhabitants was 67.62% in the United States. In Hong Kong, it was 122.665. In Israel, it was 111.04. In the Czech Republic, 115.22. Everything is about America. So we would have thought that America would have been leading. But from the statistics that we are seeing, Italy is the one that has more cell phone subscribers than any other country. Fortunately, we have South Africa also represented there, 65.36%. In terms of broadband penetration, by countries, Iceland leads. Iceland is a leading country in broadband penetration, followed by Korea, that's South Korea, and then the Netherlands is fourth, Taiwan is 12th, United States is 16th again. We would have thought that America would have been leading. There are no statistics for Africa. And then in terms of current range of information devices that are used, we have MP4 players, we have digital cameras, we have portable video players, we have iPad, we have tablets. Now we have even phablets. I'm sure you know what phablets are. If you didn't know what phablets are, described in terms of their size. They are a cross between a smartphone and a laptop. And so Samsung Galaxy Notes, for example, those are the ones that are described as phablets. And they were pioneered by Samsung from 2011. Now there are other versions. We have iTel, for example. I think it's the cheapest one that is on the market now with about 100 to 200 Ghana cedis. You can get one from Asempa phones. There have been improvements in the capacities of existing devices. For example, MP3. We used to have MP3. Now we have MP4. Okay. There's a smartphone. Formerly, we were using a 3310, Nokia 3310, if you can remember that, analog. Now everything is digital, and smartphones keep on changing all the time. Today we are at iPhone 7 and Samsung Galaxy X7 Edge. Maybe tomorrow, next year, we'll have a Samsung Galaxy Note or Samsung X8 Edge. And then we may have iPhone 8. And then maybe in 10 years' time, we'll have gone to iPhone 18 as they keep improving on it. Today, we have information service provision that has also been expanding. For example, Apple iTunes, you can download music digitally and listen to it. That's why these days, you find young people going around with plugs in their ears. When a car is coming, they are crossing the road and a car is coming, they are not bothered because they can't hear the car coming. You can download movies, Netflix, if you remember, or Iroko Television for Nigerian and Ghanaian movies. We have voice over internet protocols. We have cell phone services in flight. Formerly, when you were on the phone, on the plane, you cannot make calls. Now you can make calls in flight. That is why on your smartphones now you can see the icon for in flight. So that when you are in flight, you can activate your phone. There is blogging. So these are all current developments in the information service provision. By way of summary, let me put it that information devices and services provide information to individuals which they use for a variety of purposes as they carry out their daily life. And basically, information is used for decision making, for resolving uncertainty in our lives. I'm sure, again, if you have any issues, you can always post questions in your Sakai emails to me, and I'll be answering them. Your tutors will also be handling you, and so you can post some of the questions to them to handle. Now I want to look at uses of information in society. That's our third topic for discussion, uses of information in society. And by way of introduction, let me say that information is a powerful and indispensable factor in the operation and functioning of society. Information is power. I keep coming back to that. Or knowledge is power. And so we can use information as an instrument of influence and control in the lives of individual citizens. And as a matter of fact, information is used as an instrument of influence and control in the lives of individual citizens. Information is also used in the political structure of the country in much the same way as information is vital to the relationships among nations. In the economic environment, that is when we use information as an instrument of influence and control. In the economic environment, the use of advertising to influence behavior and therefore decisions as to what to buy. For example, if you had your own way, maybe you would have been using Omo all the time and then came in area, because that was what we were used to. Omo, you use Omo to wash your things and they become clean. And then area came and they started advertising that they have a particular chemical in their detergent which can remove all kinds of stains. And then we started patronizing Ariel, and then Omo sales went down. Then Omo came up and said that they can also do that, and they started doing it. And then there was an advertising war going on. And so yes, advertisements through economic means or in the economic environment can influence your behavior in terms of things that you decide to buy or not. In politics too, information is used to influence people's behavior. For example, citizens in their voting choices. Currently, we are in the political season, and so you can hear all manner of things which are calculated to sway you in terms of who you will vote for. I don't want to go into details here, but I'm sure if you have been listening to the radio, watching television, you will come across all these kinds of things that I'm talking about. And you'll be making your decisions come December 7th as to who you should vote for. Information is also used to shape public opinion on national issues. Currently, we are told that Electricity Corporation of Ghana or Electricity Company of Ghana is to be privatized. Now, the idea was put in the public domain for people to continue debating. Some have been arguing against it, some have been arguing for it. The government sector says that it is not the entire operations of the electricity company that is being privatized, but the management aspect of it, even though people are still kicking against it. But at the end of the day, whatever comes out of it will be based on what people have said about such a national issue, and then the government will decide to implement it or to abandon it. Again, we use information in terms of politics to inform and support public policy decisions. So before the government will take a decision, or before a government organization will take a decision, they would again sample public opinion. And then, or they will come and put it before the public, canvas public opinion, and then the decision will be taken that yes, this policy is good for us, so let's go with it. For example, the decision to go back to the IMF for them to sanction our economic recovery program, let me put it that way. There was a workshop or a seminar, if you like, that was held at Royal Senchi Hotel, for example, and it was made up of a lot of key holders or stakeholders in government, in the private sector, in the industrial sector, in the political sector, and the issues were debated, and the decision was made to go to the IMF. Now again, information is important in the political structure of a nation, and so. Key elements in establishing and managing political power base, for example, depends on information. And so, for example, the government of the day can hide certain information from the rest of the political parties, and they will not be privy to it. Let's take the debate over the furore over the Gitmo 2, that is the Guantanamo Bay prisoners that were brought into the country. They were brought into the country before Ghanaians got to know that they had been brought into the country. Government was very mindful of the fact that if they had given the information out that government was going to take two of the prisoners, the whole country will go up in uproar. They will argue against it, so government would not be able to receive them. And so the decision was taken to hide the information from the majority of Ghanaians, And then they brought them in before they released the information, okay? Information is also is important in the relationships that exist among nations. So for example, the unions that we have, EU, European Union, the African Union, the G8, etc., they all base their relationships, or their relationships strive or survive on the information that they share among themselves for the purposes of development, for the purposes of competition. Information for entertainment. Information also plays a vital role in entertainment. Okay, so sporting events. We have been privy to the Olympic Games that took place in Rio de Janeiro in Brazil quite recently. We watched it on television, we listened to it on radio. In 2014, for example, we watched the World Cup again in Brazil. Now, films. We watch films, we gain information from that, we listen to music. All of these things are for entertainment purposes, and yet we get information out of all those things. Now, as a matter of the way information has grown and the devices that we use in disseminating information, receiving and tracking information, we have lost what we call a time cushion between the occurrence of an event or a problem and the information diffusion. That is when the news comes out that something has happened. And a lot of governments take exception to that. A lot of people have been lamenting that loss of the time cushion. Because let's say, for example, a celebrity passes on all of a sudden. For example, in the case of our former president, Professor John Evans Atamios, or Mr. P.V. Obin, who unfortunately passed on at a filling station, a petrol filling station. Within minutes of it happening, it was all over the airwaves, on WhatsApp, on Facebook. People got to know about it before even the family could be informed. And so that's what we mean by the loss of time cushion. Of course, in a way, it is positive because certain aspects of information or items of information may be hidden from the general public for ulterior purposes by governments, which we think, some of us think, it's not right. And so the loss of time cushion in some instances is good, even though in some cases too, it may be negative. The loss of Malaysian Airlines flights, MH30, for example, two years ago, the moment the plane vanished off the radar, information came out. And up to now, they are still searching for the remains of the airlines. Quite recently, I think last week, it was reported that one of the wings was found in Tanzania. Look at where it happened. So, by way of summary again, because of the level of information diffusion, particularly in the aspect of entertainment, a lot of people have been expressing fears, particularly countries, that their cultures are being overwhelmed by foreign cultures. And yes, it is true. In Ghana, for example, you can hardly call a young person today to come and sit by you for you to tell him or her stories. It will be strange to them, but they will be more inclined towards putting plugs in their ears to listen to music, watching foreign movies on their smartphones or on their laptops or on their tablets, or they will rather want to go to a place to go and chill in the night. Now I hear aphrodisiac and boomerang are no longer on the top list of places where young people go to. I'm sure you know where you have been going to. Okay, so this is what I have for you so far as this topic is concerned, or this session is concerned. I hope you have followed what I'm doing. Now, as information studies students, I expect that you can also go online, you browse, you Google, you search for information for confirmation of some of the things that I have said, so you can add value to what you are learning from here. It will be unpardonable if you are an information study student and you are afraid to go online and search for information for yourselves. There are some of the things that I will explain to you. Some of them I will not explain to you, because you see, bottom line is that you are learning to become information professionals. That means you are learning to become providers of information. If you have information, it means that it keeps you several steps ahead of the average person. And so if you cannot find information for yourselves, I wonder how you'll be able to provide information for other people who need information. As I started, information is power. And therefore, those of you who are privileged to be reading this course consider yourself as people who are way ahead of others in terms of information. You should be able to search for information. You should be able to know how to handle information in order to be able to provide information for those who need information. Thank you for listening to me.